Welcome in from your SUV, from your tractor or your ute, or maybe you're even riding your electric motorbike. But from wherever you are, you're with Alistair Moorhead and Glenn Judson, and this is the Alan Juddy Show. Well, what we want to do is reach out and provide you some technical information on a range of agricultural topics which may interest you, but to do it in a different way. Casual and comfortable format that allows you to listen where you want and when you want. This is intended for general information, and for more specific advice, contact your local Agricom rep.
Here we are with Lara from marketing.
Hey guys, how you going?
Good, Lara.
Thanks, Lara.
We've got a couple of questions here. One from Sally. What does a future farm system look like with reduced cropping areas, being regulations and or more extreme weather patterns?
It's a really, again, a very difficult question because there's so many parts to it. And, you know, when I listen to that, I partially think dairy farming, but it doesn't really say ask what farming system. So let's just use dairy. I think the pressure point sits with the fact that if we move away from crops, it naturally makes people have to have more area, particularly for that wintering phase, which may not be still on the primary platform. So it will potentially increase debt in the dairy sector because people would either need to purchase more land so they can put the same number of cows over a bigger platform of grass for winter, or they have to invest in a capital infrastructure like a shed. So those two things bring debt loading to a really efficient dairy system. And I probably would suggest that if something could emerge in this country where you could have an integrated business plan, model where you've got another business sitting inside a dairy farm and it made sense, that would probably be awesome. But I'm still waiting for someone to give me an answer on that themselves, because if, you know, it's people like ourselves that help people implement those answers. And at that issue is, at the moment, in my humble opinion, it's easy to have the great question. No one's giving really comfortable answers of what are the options in real terms. So
yeah, I think it's pretty clear that if the crop comes out or crop area is limited, the cost of wintering is going to go up because the alternatives are more expensive, and that's why crop is so very useful. I think the other thing in terms of the weather events and some of the challenges that may be coming with us, so I think farming systems are going to have to be more adaptable and more resilient. And so that might mean that when we're doing the numbers around what we should do in a situation, we might be using models to predict what prices are and some of the crops we should be putting in. We'll need to factor in the fact that we don't know, understand what could be coming at us. So we need to be more resilient. We need to have more plan Bs and Cs. And so, because there's a lot of uncertainty. And so I see the diversification in terms of what those income streams are, diversification in terms of what we're growing on farm, and diversifications in terms of some of the management style. They're going to be much more diverse and therefore more complex to run. So in terms of doing that, we are going to have to rely on some technology to help us. We're going to have to be very good at changing quickly and recognising when we need to change. So forecasting and being able to get animals off quickly, or being able to use crops in two or three different ways. So I think we're going to have to become a whole lot more flexible in terms of remaining resilient when we don't understand what's coming at us.
Cool.
Nice. Another question from Nick here. He is curious, favourite farming area in the country?
Oh, I've got one.
Oh, you go first.
Yeah, West Otago. Tapanui and the greater area around there is my, I've got very fond memories of seeing that, and it's constantly seeing it in its best in the summertime. It's a great spot in the sort of the western side of the Blue Mountains there. Just beautiful landscape.
Well, for me, North Canterbury is, I'm a sort of born and bred there. There's a spot where I can look up at the hills that surround Oxford. And it's one of those things where when I fly in, when I'm coming home from a travel or when I'm driving across the Canterbury Plains, it's always, there's actually a spur that I always look for. So that's where my favourite farming area is. It's home base.
Epic. Well, if you guys have some questions, please feel free to email them through to info@agricom.co.nz or hit us up on our Facebook and Instagram pages, AgricomNZ.
Thanks, Lara.
Well, Elsa, I can tell that you've just woken up for a two-hour nap because you're looking pretty sharp.
Thanks, Juddy.
What are we going to talk about today?
Glenn, we're going to talk about alternative grass species. It's in response to a question from Alistair from Cambridge, I think it was, up in the Waikato, asking after prairie grass. And so what we thought we'd do is we'd mash that in with all the other grasses that we use in New Zealand outside our mainstream grasses. So if you don't mind, way we might handle it is we might dive into our big grasses and then highlight what are the other grasses that get used, and then you can tease out our experiences with that over time, I would suggest.
Well, that sounds like a plan. So we're talking about some of the grass species that aren't used commonly, widely through New Zealand, but do have a place. And I guess what we're going to try and get to is describe from an agronomic point of view where their place is. But knowing that it's not all about agronomy and we've got to have some good animal system stuff in there, that will then try and look at how we'd fit them into a animal system.
That's right.
Excellent. Right. So let's go for our first alternate grass or a grass other than our rye grasses and coxwains.
Well, that's what I think I would say first is, you know, like in New Zealand, by far the greatest grass species or group of grasses that we use are the rye grasses, the loliums, and that's perennial, hybrid, Italian, and annual ryegrass, by far the biggest. There's huge gulf between that and any other species we use. And if we look at the next tier down, which for some people, they describe them as secondary grasses already, Coxford and tall fescue would sit in those that place in the New Zealand farming system. So then you get to what other grasses are in our landscape and we use.
And just to give some clarity, actually we've done a podcast on those other species.
Correct. So this is just filling in the gaps of what else. And again, it's a answering the question about prairie grass. And that's a really nice place to kick off. So probably one of the more significant volumes of grass, alternate grasses we use in New Zealand is the brome species. And this is where you could probably get into a bit of trouble, but I'm going to try and pronounce the Latin names of these grasses.
This is going to be great.
So some of our audiences will not know them by their common names in the New Zealand landscape, but you'll recognise them significantly in South America and different parts of the world which use the species. But we predominantly use three brome grasses in New Zealand.
Yep.
And I would describe it quite simply is that there is a grass that replicates or looks very, very similar to an Italian ryegrass. There's a grass that looks very similar in functions, very similar to hybrid ryegrasses. And then there is a brome grass that is actually very much more similar to a very traditional, tough perennial ryegrass.
Right.
And so we'll start with the start where we're talking about prairie grass, which is Bromus willardinii.
Well done.
Which I think sit with that, but that
sounds like a suburb in Dunedin.
Yes,
actually, but
it
anyway,
does, almost with a wee musical tinge to the end of that. But the point being, prairie grass is a really.
Is that the perennial end?
No, that's the Italian end.
That's the Italian end.
That's the
right.
Shorter term end.
Right.
Upright, broad, open, quite active in both winter and summer. To be fair, we describe it as having a pretty consistent growth curve. That's not right because all grasses grow more in spring. But it never really drops away in summer, and it continues to grow in moderately dry conditions through summer and autumn, and it has quite significant winter growth, and not dissimilar to an Italian. So, to be fair, it's probably a summer active Italian, coming from a different species perspective. But like all the bromes, this particular one has very big seed. The seed doesn't reflect the the amount of energy it's got to actually become a plant out of that seed. The seed is just a big husk, which we can't get rid of. So we've got to be very careful with this plant, because when you see the size of its seed, one, you've got to watch how much you sow, because you need to sow a bit more because the seed is so large. But the weakness is people think it looks like an oat.
Yes.
So you go and punch it in the ground and it doesn't come up.
And that's why, now that makes sense to me, is why a 25-kilogram bag of prairie grass seed looks enormous.
It is, because to be fair, it's not as bad as coxfoot, to be quite frank, but the point being, there's very few, relatively speaking, there's only about 30 to 40% of the amount of seed in a 25 kg bag of prairie grass as in an Italian ryegrass.
Yes.
Because it's so much bigger. So again, that sowing rate for the prairie grass is quite a big deal. But more importantly, as a farm systems and delivering it perspective, it still needs to be delivered at about 1 centimetre to 1.5 centimetres of depth. Just because the seed looks big, the energy in that seed is actually no different to any other grass. And if you'd bury it, it won't come up.
So what's the sowing rate? If you were putting in a prairie grass and clover mix, for example, what sort of sowing rate would you sow prairie grass at?
Oh, look, because it's quite a big plant, what does grow fills out. And in many of our systems we use prairie grass in, we actually quite like the openness. So sometimes having less is not a bad thing. And I'll explain a couple of other traits of it. That means having a little bit less than the theoretical sowing rate is not a problem. However, if you wanted to really compete for outright yield with this species, over 30 kilograms per hectare is what you would be sowing.
Right.
So from that perspective, I very rarely see that. It is likely to max out at 25 k's a hectare as a part of the mixture, and predominantly it sits at anywhere between 10, maybe 4 kilograms, right through to about 16 kilograms in a pasture mixture. We'll delve into that a little bit more shortly. But the key to the species, this is the bromus species, but particularly the prairie grass represents this, is that they are a grass of free-draining, quite light and fertile soils. So prairie grass particularly likes good phosphate, which, you know, many grasses, the phosphate's not about the grass, it's about the legumes that you may want in your mixture. So you're not elevating your phosphate for grass, although phosphate helps with their root development and structures like that. It's not a massive necessity. You want good pHs because you don't want other toxic issues emerging like aluminium and stuff like that, and particularly with prairie grass. But the point being is that prairie grass is a very big productive plant, and it seems to elevate its resilience quite dramatically in the presence of high phosphate levels. It's one of the grasses I would suggest that is quite linked to high phosphate, is quite heavily linked to longevity and natural seedling recruitment, which comes back to the sowing rate. One reason you can get away with slightly lower sowing rates with prairie grass, it's a very free seeding species. It starts seeding at the end of our first month of spring, and it doesn't stop seeding till the middle of autumn. So it produces seed head literally the whole calendar year.
So just picking up on that from an animal performance point of view, tell me a little bit about the palatability of the seed head. Is that a really big issue in terms of grazing?
Yes, well, we have discussed that with other species like continental tall fescue, where seed head is quite regularly a limitation. I think the locations that prairie grass is used and the quantities it's used in means that the seed head is not an overwhelming problem, but most importantly, cattle particularly find it highly palatable. So it's something that is actively grazed out in a cattle grazing event. Sheep can get a little bit more selective, but they will still take the seed head. Now, the point being, with all species, stem is stem. Just because they want to eat it doesn't mean it will make them grow. It will fill them up. It might give them a bigger gut fill. But as you and I both know, it's still stem. It's still lignifying plant parts. So my point being is that it can be managed more easily than virtually every other grass we have when it goes to seed. However, don't believe that enhances your animal performance.
So
it's not elite.
No, stem, and I think that's a really important point there. If you were looking at its growth habit and when you're going to get the most production out of this, knowing that you're in free draining soils. When's its real power in terms of producing a lot of dry matter?
Well, for me, it's two very distinct time frames. It's spring full stop. You need to drive your production system. If you're coming out of a cold winter landscape, you need spring to be very, very early and very powerful. However, it's probably that autumn accumulation and winter cover that in a temperate landscape and even some of our colder environments, first, second, and even third year prairie grass can actually have a surprising bulk going into the winter, which, you know, for cattle systems is really important.
So a little bit, what we're saying, a little bit on the shoulders of the season, probably you're going to get some benefits, particularly in free draining situations. If you were in areas that periodically flood, are you likely to be able to hold this plant for long periods?
No, not in its perennial state, but it doesn't mean to say a whole lot of seed didn't just wash in from the literally the sides of your rivers. So it likes free-draining silt loams. So it does populate free-draining silty areas, for example. And what you tend to find is after floods, prairie grass is a colonizer, assuming the fertility is there. If the fertility is not there, it's actually quite a small plant with lots of seed head. If the fertility there, it's a big leafy plant.
And what's its clover compatibility like?
Well, it's very upright and open, so it's actually highly compatible. So if I dive into some of the systems that would be used in, like, for example, it doesn't like intense set stocking. It doesn't like intense rotations where you're coming back too fast. You make it more and more open and make the plant weaker and weaker with time. So it sits out at about a 30-day rotation. And it loves free-draining soils and loves good fertility within reason. So it is a natural to be stitched into lucerne stands that are just finishing. So for the last two or three years of a lucerne stand where you may want to transition from a lucerne dominant situation into a grazing situation, adding prairie grass to that role is actually one of its really top jobs. If I was then to just discuss how you might utilize it on, again, light free draining soils of 600 mil to 900 mil rainfall, another great set of species that fit with prairie grass beautifully are literally sowing it with lucerne, red clover, chicory, plantain, and probably something like a medium to large white clover. And they all function really, really well together in a finishing system. So quite ideal for some of the deer finishing systems in the spring. Definitely all classes of cattle. And you could definitely run a lamb program around that, but you're probably looking to bring cattle in as part of that rotation as well.
My impression is that where you have the species in, it's not critical, but you seem the outcomes are so much better when you have cattle in that system.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Okay, so now we've talked about that down that Italian end, if you like, of the brown species.
I'll just finish a couple of things in context from a New Zealand perspective, and just for Alistair up north, particularly discussing the prairie grass. One of the weaknesses with prairie grass up north is that it is vulnerable to a pasture pest called Hessian fly, and that is predominantly found in the north of New Zealand. It doesn't particularly have any endophytes associated with it, so it has the chance to be still eaten by things like African black beetle, native grass scrub, and things like that. So although resilient, it's in that sort of longer rotation with cattle, particularly in fertile landscapes, it still has not a huge amounts of protection. If there's any sort of protection that prairie grass actually has, is it's through natural reseeding. However, when we sell prairie grass seed in New Zealand, we have it's fungicide treated because a very, very natural disease of prairie grass is head smut. And so when you get head smut in nature, you literally aren't producing fertile seed. So that's a really big deal. And the only other thing I would say with prairie grass that I see as a threat in some of the longer pasture rotations and autumn save grazing environments is that if you're in that sort of autumnal with a bit of moisture, cooling down, the risk of getting ergot is quite important. So head smut is a very black, sooty substance that is colonizing where the seed should be. Ergot is literally a solid fruiting body that looks exactly like ratchet. sitting, colonising exactly where a seed would be. Now, ergot is a real risk to animal health and well-being. So, as you have discussed in passing, full of ergovalin-type products, and they're vascular constrictors. So at high levels, they can cause some quite harm to stressed animals in the cold or the heat.
Yeah, certainly. And they periodically, you know, given the environment, those do pop up from time to time, particularly in wet, warm environments. So take that on board.
And so deferring feed, for example, into winter, sometimes you got to actually do think of unintentional consequences. Prairie grass is a tick because it can be done and it does it well. But if it's carrying lots and lots of seed head, you only need one bad autumn.
Yes.
And some of that crop and some of that deferred pasture may actually be not usable easily without harming animals.
Yes.
So yeah, it is something that I would say is a low risk, but when it happens, it is very, very difficult to deal with.
Yes, yes. And probably we get to that point, the recommendation is likely to be that you can silage that. The difficulty is that that you don't do anything to the ergot. The ergot is still intact.
Correct.
It's just that you're feeding it out in smaller amounts.
Dilute it down.
And therefore you can get away with that. But it still doesn't, it still creates a real problem. You don't
correct.
Have too many exits out of it.
You may have to top it early, and which gives up valuable volume.
All right, so now we've talked about the Italian end of that. Let's talk about what you'd class as more the hybrid.
Yes. In New Zealand, we class this category as pasture brome. It's Bromus valdivianus, and this brome is a much more densely tillered style of plant. It's still bigger than a traditional ryegrass, but not as big as an Italian. So it sits in between. Interestingly enough, it is not as winter active as a prairie grass. And I would probably, the variety we have here in New Zealand, I would also describe as being quite late flowering. For me personally, that means it's slightly better tolerant to a slightly higher rainfall. All of these bromes are very tolerant to summer conditions in general terms, if the fertility is good enough. And the pasture brome I see is quite a really highly functional grass in some of our more continental landscapes where we can be cold in winter, where you're not expecting a huge amount of growth, but you can pick up some late moisture in spring on free draining light soils. And so it fits quite strongly in that space for me. I see that as a very strong complementary grass with red clover and white clover and possibly subterranean clover.
And what sort of animal system would you be looking? Is this still a finishing feed?
Yeah, no, I'd definitely be seeing it as quite a wide diversity. This is still a cattle feed. And when it goes to seed, it's actually quite an intense seeder at the start of the first month of summer. It's very, very late, so it throws a lot of stem and seed head there. Being a brome, it's relatively palatable, but it's got a longer, taller seed head as well. So the thing is, it still fits within a cattle system, but this is a grass I'd be very happy for deer and sheep to be eating quite easily and not damaging it. Much more tolerant to periods of set stocking, for example. And from there, I think we should carry on down because this next one we've had quite a history with it, which is the grazing brome, which is the perennial end of the spectrum. This is a species that literally requires a rainfall zone under 800 millimetres. At about 800 millimetres, you do see it actually ecologically come outside its zone, and you tend to find it dies. So the areas that we've been involved with, Bromus stemianus, is in very, very light free draining soils of about 550 mils to about 750 mils, very light country that you really only get a period of growth at the end of autumn and really at the start of spring. Now, as I said, prairie grass flowers all the time. Pasture brome tends to flower quite late. Grazing brome flowers really early and then stops because it's a perennial.
Yep.
So that's late September. And it's a very small plant, and it's really genuinely designed for quite intense stocking. So this is where you have sheep and you're just stocking it constantly. In New Zealand, I would say about 75% of the natural landscape that grazing brome would have been used on historically is now growing grapes.
Right, so it's that type of country.
Absolutely. So we're talking Marlborough, we're talking North Canterbury, prime grape-growing country in North Canterbury are all historic places where grazing brome was used with half-bred sheep, merinos, corridor sheep breeds and, you know, quite a semi-arid landscape.
And so given the fact that it is flowering early in the season, does that indicate that from a stage of growth point of view that you're likely to get quite a lot early spring.
Yes, and slightly more in winter. So it's more winter active than a pasture biome. It's more active at the end of autumn, winter, and early spring, recognising its job in life really for the rest of the year is to tolerate what's thrown at it.
Yeah.
And of all the grass species I've seen in that situation, it's one of the most amazing true semi-arid grass species that I've actually seen it green up literally if an irrigator's been taken across it in a completely brown landscape. I've literally within 24 hours seen it trigger a regrowth reaction. And now typically that's a really bad thing for a plant that's trying to survive summer. However, this species seems to be so tolerant to that because it greens up, could be utilized and then goes back into a brown state and into survival mode. But the speed that it greens up is just phenomenal, and I've never seen anything quite like it. Those brome species for me are really important. I would just leave a take-home message with them. Please be aware they do have limits on their rainfall zones for their natural performance, and I would suggest they all benefit from free-draining soils. Yes, they may be periodically able to grow in slightly higher rainfall and wet areas, but you will not receive their full potential in those landscapes. They will die faster or rely on reseeding to be perennial.
And probably the competition from other grasses that are more
successful
in that situation.
Absolutely. So now we move into a group of grasses that are used, but let's just say that they are more components of mixtures, both the pasture brome and the grazing brome tend to be a primary component. Prairie grass can be a primary component or a small part of a mixture. The first one, I'd probably focus on two continental grasses. One of them is meadow fescue, and we've touched on this when we discussed tall fescue, and meadow fescue is going to have a significant future in the New Zealand landscape for mixing with tall fescue to improve pasture management, and combined with its novel endophytes or its natural endophytes, provide a broader alkaloid profile into a fescue pasture. So meadow fescue we're talking about is Festuca pratensis, which is technically continental grass, and the reality for us is it grows, has a very low growth point through late autumn to literally the first month of spring. So for us, that's actually quite dormant. As I say, we value this grass at this moment at Agricom, particularly because we are utilising it with the variety Oakden in pasture mixes with our current continental fescue portfolio. So we're using meadow fescue with tall fescue to improve the pasture management because the meadow fescue is highly palatable. So that's been its primary use. And I would say it's a very niche product at this moment, but I think it's finding a place in life in the New Zealand pastoral system.
And I think we can't underestimate, or we shouldn't understate, how big a difference that that mixing actually, how big an effect that has actually created.
Yes, you're living that at Marshdale at the moment.
And I think
that's 3 years old.
And we can still see the line in an open paddock where we've got continued improved grazing. And I guess the question I've got is, will that actually reduce the longevity of the plant in that because it's being more well grazed on a number of different occasions? And I guess that's the lasting question that I have in terms of, does it make controlling tall fescue easy? I would say undoubtedly it does.
Yeah. So we're very lucky. Our colleagues in Australia, for example, you know, the meadow fescue is a soft species. And in a hard environment, a soft species is a soft species,
yes,
which basically means it just doesn't last or doesn't survive. It may not even survive one summer in Australia. Admittedly, having its endophyte present is the difference between it surviving one summer in New Zealand as well. So it is not a very perennial species if it doesn't have its endophyte. It will literally just drop dead.
And so just unpacking that endophyte, it's one of these ones that have got significant amounts of lolenes that are circulating in the roots, and this is likely to infer at least some protection against our root feeders.
Absolutely. And you know, there's no doubt about it that lolenes are doing a lot of different things with this plant. So, look, as I say, this would be what I'd describe as a very niche grass species in the history of New Zealand. I think it has never really completely naturalised here, but I don't think we understood endophyte when it first came into the New Zealand in the 50s and 60s. It never naturalised. But I also now believe categorically we never understood endophyte until the start of the 80s. And this plant is nothing special and has no perenniality of significance if it doesn't have its endophyte.
Yes. And so it's not a grass that you would sow by itself?
For me, first things first, we sow very few monocultures in New Zealand. That word gets bandied around a lot, but the only monocultures in our pastoral systems that we sow is some of the annuals, which we're using to clean up weeds between cropping rotations. I would never sow a perennial-like species without a number of other species in there, which is including, in this case, red clover. So the only place I would use it as a primary grass in a mixture, is where I'm worried about red clover not surviving because of insect pressure, particularly native grass grub. Yep. So these are the scarab underground feeders. And having a grass species like meadow fescue, which is non-aggressive either, allowing red clover to fulfill all its productive potential for lamb finishing and silaging and and those sort of systems that we run, I would suggest meadow fescue may very well provide the sustainability of that red clover for as long as relish will last. Using our grazing type as an example, there's every chance that might last 5-6 years if the grass is there to both keep out the weeds, utilize some free nutrient, but also keep out the bugs.
Yep.
So moving into another continental grass, which has quite a lot of world history, is Timothy, which is phloem pretensis. Timothy is another continental grass, which again, a very dormant phase. Again, very, very close to 5 months where it's not actually growing to any great extent. And in the New Zealand system, that has only got a very limited amount of areas where that's beneficial. However, Timothy is one of those grasses that has a huge amount of seed. It's very, very small. So putting a small amount into a mixture is a really positive thing. And I look at Timothy in a pasture mixture as a filler. It's a positive pasture species that fills the gap of what would be naturally colonized by things like poa annua, small weed grasses and other things. So I look at putting Timothy in a mix as something that, one, adds a bit of diversity for stock acceptance, particularly sheep. But the reality for me is it's a second or tertiary sort of grass species that's a gap filler. You get a lot of seed for just a kilogram of seed, and it's almost like no harm, no foul.
Right.
It is actually possibly offering more, but it's actually quite a small component, and it's definitely only filling gaps.
The one thing that I always recognise about Timothy, and it's one I always remember, it's probably one of the few things I remember about Timothy, is the fact that it flowers really late.
Really late. So pretty much in the New Zealand system, it's pretty much around our middle of summer, the end of the first month of summer, you will be driving around the countryside, and on the roadside there will be grass with a very distinctive cigarette-like, almost the length of your middle finger, and shaped like a cigarette seed head. And so anywhere between the middle of summer to the second month of summer, which is really, really late from a species perspective. There's very few grasses that are just starting to go to full seed head at that point. So that also highlights the sort of landscapes that it has evolved in. And the fact that I've talked about it being on the roadside also highlights it likes more lax environments. I will mention some of its special powers as far as where it does fit. It does fit in the high value hay production systems for the horse industry. This is a species that can regularly be cut for some very, very high quality hay and is highly sought after from Southeast Asian racing environments, Japan, and traded out into those landscapes and containers. Huge amounts of that actually gets traded. What's its special power when it comes to the hay type scenario? Well, one of the things is that the stems, while maintaining the level of dry matter that you require to make hay successfully without burning down the ship, stay green. And so for such a low quality component, which, stemmy hay is quite a low quality component, Timothy maintains a surprisingly high level of color, high level of green. And that creates this very high quality hay. And for horses with no secondary plant compounds that are negative, it fits in as a premium horse hay product. So that would be one of its biggest revivals in our world, which is the tightly packed bales that are exported around the world. And so it's a pretty professional system. And the last two grasses to cover off for us, for me personally, are grasses associated with quite extreme landscape change. On average, New Zealand stretches predominantly in a temperate zone, but in the low rainfall eastern side of New Zealand, you describe us at times as almost semi-arid, i.e. we're getting rainfalls down around 550 to 650 mils and have water deficits for about 4 months of the year. Hence, where, you know, the Canterbury Plains is quite an irrigated landscape. And then you go to the top of the North Island of New Zealand and you are in a latitude that's not miles off Sydney in Australia. So you're looking at nudging on the subtropical zones, basically. And so we go from about 200 Ks-ish south of Tasmania in Australia to about Sydney is the length in New Zealand and the ranges of climates. So if we start at the top and we start working our way in, what you'd have noticed by my statement of being about the latitude that, for example, Sydney in Australia is, we are in a oceanic subtropical zone. And Kaikuyu is definitely part of the northern, very northern part of the New Zealand pastoral landscape. And to be quite frank, it's starting to move a little bit too. So there'll be many, many listeners from outside New Zealand that would be far more familiar with Kaikuyu. And on average, it's a grass that fits into cattle systems a lot more than sheep systems. It requires a lot of management to get the best out of it in a dairy system, particularly in the subtropical dairy environments. You tend to find it requires good grazing management, good nitrogen use, and these things are really important. But it is a very perennial grass in the system that can be very, very useful for getting from late spring through to early to mid-autumn. But then you tend to find Kaikuyu creates a big chasm of productivity as you come out of that early autumn growth phase before you can get your temperate grass systems re-established and re-firing up, basically. So in the New Zealand system at the moment, we're still running a very, very much a hybrid system where we can almost get perennial ryegrass to be useful. And if we can, we do. But it's awfully hard to keep Kaikuyu out of those landscapes, and therefore you tend to revert to an undersowing or stitching in process of where you're coming into your Kaikuyu landscape with Italian or annual ryegrass and then transitioning through into temperate annual ryegrasses back into Kaikuyu the following summer. So we are pretty much following what most producers around the world would do with Kaikuyu in those landscapes. But at the moment, we can still do a bit of perennial ryegrass, we can still do some tall fescue, and you really only go to Kaikuyu on the country that you can't stop it. So does that sort of cover that one? Have you any experience with that?
Yeah, I think from the Kaikuyu situation, I think the critical thing is that, as you say, if our ryegrasses are running out and Kaikuyu is invading or becoming dominant, I think that demonstrates that it is quite at home in that environment. And I think there's two options. Either you try and do things to keep it out, and that is, you know, you have strong perennial ryegrass, for example, or tall fescue in those systems. Or what you do is you use it and you manage it and then fill in that, as you say, that chasm that occurs over that cooler period. And so I think the way, if we're in a situation where Kaikuyu is going to be part of your system, you come up with a forage system that takes advantage of trying to manage that and manage the quality in that, but also be able to capture some of the benefits of other species as you put that into that situation.
A really good example, again, in the Northland landscape would be Kaikuyu summer pastures. One of the strategies around that would be running both either turnips or chicory, for example, as a complementary summer crop, where you've got the really highly digestible feed, the protein sources coming from your cropping system, where you're coming to the fibre and the bulk of the Kaikuyu to be a filler, basically, or moderate quality filler for
hold that stock.
Right? Yeah, correct, of those lactating cows. And you're probably looking at a bit of supplement through it too to get them through to where you want them to be. The last species is Phalaris aquatica. I always smile at this because I have had a little bit of history with my our plant breeder, Dr. Alan Stewart, with Phalaris arundinaceae, which is swamp Phalaris. And it always makes me smile when the traditional Phalaris used in the Australian landscape is Phalaris aquatica. So we are talking about the traditional flaris used in the arid and semi-arid landscapes of Australia, particularly where it's one of the more perennial species they work with. Its role in New Zealand is very minor. We have had a long history of it within Agricom. We've had a bit of personal history with it, doing some studies at Lincoln University and seeing some of the negative things that can occur if you get grazing in the autumn wrong. It's a very perennial species, really massive root mass. In its steady state, it is quite a crown and very, very deep root structure. But I must emphasise, in the New Zealand system, it hasn't naturalised widely around New Zealand. The places that you may yet see flaris having naturalised, again, is in the road sites, but not in the paddocks. And when you are driving around your landscape and you're paying a little bit of attention to the ecology of the world, you know, that should ring bells straight away. If something can naturalize on a roadside but not move into the paddock, you have to ask yourself, why isn't it crossing the fence and moving into the paddock? And quite regularly it is because our intensity in the New Zealand, our expectation of grazing, our numbers of grazings, our intensity, it is just a little bit of a different level because we are, even if we think we've got it hard because of a dry phase or a whatever, we are still quite a soft country, relatively speaking. So it is definitely a pasture species of a far less intense grazing practices. You tend to attempt to build up more mass. You tend to use it for longer periods and then give big breaks. All of these things that aren't always an obvious management structure in the New Zealand system. Some pretty strong characteristics associated with it: tolerance of insects and bugs. The thing that I just can't shake off is that it has got alkaloids that can create sudden death syndrome and stagger events that are quite destructive. My experience with the staggers is that eventually those same animals die at a later date. So a little bit of that is to do with cobalt deficiencies in the New Zealand landscape and combined with the alkaloids of early autumn regrowth. However, like I say, I always get concerned because you start off by putting a little bit in, but you don't know where you'll be in 6 years or 8 years, and you don't know. To date, I have never seen it naturalize.
Right.
And so that should still make you start to ask the question, is it the amazing perennial species, you know, in the areas that it just doesn't spread and naturalize? Because it does seed prolifically and birds do move it around.
Yeah, my impression of this is it's probably not a natural New Zealander. No. in our environment. No. And therefore, putting it in, I think that's why you're not seeing this. It's not moving into areas because we just don't have those areas where we've got the challenges that mean it's prolific. Right. And so it's an alternative grass. I can't think of too many environments that I'd stick it into, and I'm probably less likely to nominate any animal systems where I can see a huge benefit for this.
Yeah, I think cattle systems works very well because often in the spring it does get away and designed to get away, so it can build up a mass. Cattle systems with flaris fit quite well. Sometimes it's the extensive sheep grazing that can literally graze it out with long-term management, and that's where grazing tolerance types are coming out of the Australian programs. But on the scale of things, like I say, it's certainly a backbone to perenniality in Australia. But as you've also said, you know, it's still got to compete with other existing species for space in this landscape. It also has to compete with the productivity of those species, which increases the numbers of grazings and the intensity of grazing. So those things all do add up. But yeah, I've definitely experienced a few people that have harnessed it and utilized it in a few places. But I still would say, you know, it's in this topic because it's not obvious that it's better than some of the things we've already got.
So that's been a really interesting traverse, actually, through a number of different grass species. We kind of lump them together because they're what we call the alternative grasses. But I think what you've demonstrated is that they do have quite different characteristics and therefore quite different ranges in terms of where you'd sow them, and then some quite different jobs in animal systems. So I think that's been really useful, because sometimes we just lump them all together, and there's the danger is that we just think of them as the same, and they're actually quite different. So that's been really useful.
Yeah, thanks, Judy. And that's the point, is it is actually, it's one of these things about the phase we're going through where diversity is, you know, an attractive discussion. However, ecology is also a very important discussion, because, you know, I've mentioned you driving around and looking what's there. I mentioned seeing things on roadsides that are not in paddocks. You know, all of these things are describing the ecological niches and fits of these things. So go and just chuck bromes at 1200 mil rainfall zones, humid environments on clay downs. Ecology would say you can do whatever you like, but the plant isn't happy with what you've just done to it.
Yeah, I think.
And so my point being is that, you know, you can do whatever you like with mixtures, but there are a set of species fits. Yeah. And the reality is you can make as many mixes as you like, but it's ordained to what's going to end up happening because of where they come from, where they evolved, and much of that is quite known.
And I'd also throw in there and grazing management. I mean, I think that very diverse pasture that we've been dealing with, where there's been a number, 28 different species, that's been very temporary for that very reason. The ecology says that actually there are some grasses in here that can't compete and will drop out of that mixture, and the successful ones are the ones that have evolved in this type of environment and can cope with the grazing management that we throw at it.
100%. And out of interest, there's about 4 of them out of 28 that can cope with this tile of management that you have employed in that project. And that's this point is not everything likes one recipe. And once you create your recipe, you define your future.
Yeah, and so I think it's really important then to look at what you've got left, because for me, they are the things where from a perennialty point of view, they've got the best chances of being productive in that environment.
No, so and probably just to sum it up is that these species are very useful in the New Zealand landscape. We do appreciate them. They are, and we support these species in our portfolio as well. So we've always valued the majority of these species. So the point really is that there is a place. We love working with them when it offers our farming community value. We definitely do not take them to people that don't need them or it doesn't fit them. And as I say, probably that's the big message I would give, is that it's important to understand what they are and how they work to get the best out of them and do them justice and make them highly functional in your landscape.
Well, it's been good chat, Alistair. I think that's we've covered a lot of ground there, but time to draw that to a close. I've got to shoot out and pick up the mail, so we'll talk to you soon.
See you, Juddy.